Hello guys, welcome back. In the last video, we had discussed about pointers in C. And now that we are well acquainted with arrays and pointers, now we shall discuss dynamic memory allocation. Until now, whatever we had done with arrays, we had been doing statically. That means the size of the array was predefined before user did anything else. Okay, but that has a problem. What if you do not know what size of array you need to use later on? That becomes a problem. So that problem is resolved using dynamic memory allocation. Now, dynamic memory allocation can be done in two manners, or rather we have two methods which can help us to perform dynamic memory allocation. The first one is the malloc and the second one is calloc. Both of these functions allocate memory dynamically, and this dynamically allocated memory is stored on the heap. Heap is a storage space obviously in the computer memory, but then heap is a separate piece of memory in which all dynamic memory allocation takes place. So the first one is malloc. Let us discuss it. Malloc stands for memory allocation. M for memory and rest is alloc. Now, how this malloc works? This malloc is a function which reserves a block of memory of specified size, and malloc returns a pointer of void type. Now, the syntax of malloc is this. PTR, which is a pointer obviously, is equal to cast type star. This cast type is nothing but the type of variable that you want to, or rather the type of input that you want to take from the user. Suppose you want to create an integer array and you want to take inputs into that integer array, you will use int star instead of this cast type. If you want to take some character as input, then you will use char star. For float, you will write float star, and so on. And malloc, byte size. This byte size means size of whatever type you are using. For int, obviously it is 4. So let's take an example. Over here, ptr is equal to int star malloc 100 into size of int. So the type is int, that's why over here also I have written size of int, and size of int is 4 bytes, and malloc 100. This 100 means 100 blocks of spaces will be allocated to this particular pointer, to this pointer, okay? Now, 100 into size of int. Size of int is 4, so 100 into 4 means 400. So basically, 400 bytes of space has been allocated in the heap. If sufficient space cannot be allocated, then malloc will return null. Now, we have to check this every time. Now, what happens is, during dynamic memory allocation, it may happen that the heap memory gets over, or rather heap memory is no longer available. Then in that case, sufficient space cannot be allocated. That's why malloc returns a null to this PTR. Now we have calloc. Calloc stands for contiguous allocation. Calloc allocates multiple blocks of memory, each of the specified size, and sets all byte to zero. This is a very important point that you must notice. This is the major difference between calloc and malloc. In case of malloc, only one block of memory is allocated, but the size of that one block is the total size. Okay, for example, over here we had written 100 into size of int. So if we do that using malloc, then we get only one block, which is of 400 bytes in size. But if we do the same thing in calloc, we will have 100 blocks, each of size 4 bytes, and all those blocks will be allocated contiguous locations in the memory. Okay, now this is the syntax of calloc. Again, we have this cast type star calloc n comma element size. So this n is the number of elements in your array, and element size is obviously the size of this type. For example, if you use a float over here, then you'll have to write size of float. If we have allocated some dynamic memory, then we obviously are using some space on the heap. Once the work with this dynamically allocated space is over, we need to free that space so that in future we can use some more dynamically allocated space. In case you do not free that, then what will happen? The heap size will keep getting occupied by new dynamically allocated memory, and it will never get freed. And in turn, a time will come when your heap will be full. That's why it is always a good practice to use this free function. For example, if you are writing PTR over here, then once your work with this memory block is over, you should free it using the free function, and you write it as free, and inside the argument you write PTR. we have one more function which is realloc. In some cases it might happen that the previously allocated dynamically memory runs short. That means your work was not accomplished using the previously allocated memory. So you need to increase the size of that block. So that is done using realloc. Its syntax is ptr equals to realloc ptr comma new size. This ptr is the pointer to which memory was dynamically allocated earlier. This is the new size that you want to allocate.
So now let us quickly take a look at the code. So first of all, as usual, we will include the necessary header files. So hash include stdio.h and hash include stdlib.h. Over here I am including this stdlib, that is the standard library, because the malloc, calloc, realloc function, etc. are contained in this particular library. Now let us define our main method. Let's say if we take few variables, c size, m size, I will be used as the counter obviously. Then we have the cptr and say mptr. Okay, so first we will use malloc. So let's write using malloc. Let's say new line. Printf, enter the size. So first of all, we will take the size of the array from the user. That means the user will enter how large does he want to make his array, and accordingly we shall allocate dynamic memory. So we will take this input into m size. Why m size? Because actually the only reason behind giving it is m size mptr and c size cptr was that m stands for malloc and c stands for calloc. So m size is this one for malloc, and later on we will use c size for calloc. So we've taken the size as the input. Now let us define the mptr, that is int star malloc m size into size of int. So that was the general declaration over here. Let's say using malloc. Yes, so this was the method how we used to define a pointer containing malloc. So ptr is equal to int star malloc 100 into size of int. So instead of 100 we have written m size over here. Why? Because we have taken the size as input from the user. Now that we have our mptr, let's take the input from the user. So how many inputs we will take? We will take one less than the value of m size. So I is equal to 0, I less than m size, I plus plus. Inside this, let us write printf enter. Okay, let's write enter value percentage d. So I'm taking the input of value as the input from the user. Now I write scanf percentage d comma ampersand mptr I. Okay, so we have taken the input. Now using the same kind of a for loop, we will also print the output. So we have value as this is mptr. This, so value percentage mod obviously we will have twice. we have taken the input, yes, and we are giving the necessary output. So inside this, let's write this. So that will be the output for the value that we have taken inside mptr. Now we will do apparently the same thing for calloc as well. Okay, so excuse me. So over here, what I'll do is just copy this stuff and paste it. So we are using calloc, so I'll write c size here. This will be c size. CPTR again C size. This will be CPTR C size and CPTR. So that is probably it. We don't need to do anything special for calloc, just that it's all the same, only the only there is a difference between the declaration or allocation, memory allocation. So if you must have noticed, in case of malloc, I had written msize multiplied by size of int, and in case of calloc, I am writing c size comma size of int. So that is the only difference. Now let's see. Yeah, so this one, ptr is equal to cast type. In this case, I am using an int, so I'll use int star calloc n comma element size. Element size we are getting using size of int. So we have done for calloc, we have done for malloc. Okay, let's print a new line over here. And maybe a new line over here. Okay, let us save this file as, this will be a C file, say dynamic. We have saved the file. Now let us run the file. Okay, before doing that, it's okay, compile and run. So probably there are no errors. Let us wait for the compilation to take place, and until then what we can do is, let's see. Just to inform you, the compiler that I'm using over, or rather this software that I'm using here, is dev C++. Okay, so that this is the software that I'm using. Maybe sometimes you'll also find me using notepad++, but in case of dev C++, as you see, we get the compiler inbuilt. That means the editor and the compiler, both of them we have together. But in case of notepad++, if you use it, then you need to compile using the command line. Okay, so in this case there are no errors probably. So let's enter the size and the values. Let the first value be say 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. So that's what we have got. Whatever we had entered, we have got the output. Now using calloc, let us say the size is again 5 and the same values, so 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. So we've got the same output. Okay, I have not formatted the output, that's why it's looking like this. But anyways, you can do it as per your wish. So that's the working program. Now one more thing that we can do is, actually after we have done completed our work using mptr, then we must also free it. Okay, whenever we use dynamic memory allocation, okay, or whenever we perform dynamic memory allocation, we should always make it a point to free the memory once we are done using it. So that's why I have written free mptr and free cptr over here. Now as you will see, that makes no difference to the code, or that makes no difference to the output. Okay, so enter the size, say 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5. So the output is same for malloc and likewise for calloc as well. So that's the same output that as we got earlier. So that was the use of malloc and calloc, and this is very much how you need to be using it in any of the programs that you do. Okay, the requirement of the program may be different, but the syntax for using this will always be the same. So I would suggest this is a very important topic, and I'd suggest that you understand this very nicely, and then later on try and implement it yourself using different use cases. Okay, so only once you implement the code yourself will you be able to understand how it actually works. So that was all for this video. Thank you.